Rachel Schubert. Yeah, nice to see a Schubert up here, Ian, leading. So we're going to be doing part three, and why don't we stand for the reading of God's Word? Shall we do that? And we're reading from Jonah chapter 3. I'm reading from the NLT version from verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Jonah a second time. Get up and go to the great city of Nineveh and deliver the message I have given you. You all have a message because you all have a voice. His was to deliver something to Nineveh, but you all have a message. You all have a voice. Every one of you here has something to contribute to this world. You're not born just by chance. In verse 3, it says, this time Jonah obeyed the Lord's command and went to Nineveh, a city so large that it took 3 days to see it all. On the day Jonah entered the city, he shouted to the crowds, 40 days from now, Nineveh will be destroyed. That's a message of hope right there. The people of Nineveh believed God's message. From the greatest to the least, they declared a fast and put on burlap to show their sorrow. Nineveh had one preacher, one message to turn to God. How many preachers and how many messages is it going to take to turn some people's lives? They only had one preacher and one message. And if you're watching online, this could be your morning to give your life to Christ. You may not need another message to hear it. They had one preacher and one message. And in verse 6, when the king of Nineveh heard that Jonah was saying what he was saying, he stepped down from his throne, because that's what you need to do to be humbled, and took off his royal robes. He dressed himself in burlap and sat on the heap of ashes. Then the king and his nobles sent this decree throughout the city: not one, not even the animals from your herds and flocks, may eat or drink anything at all. People and animals alike must wear garments of mourning, and everyone must pray earnestly to God. They must turn from their evil ways and stop all their violence. And who can tell in verse 9, perhaps yet God will change his mind and hold back his fear, anger from destroying us. And when God saw what they had done and how they had put a stop to the evil ways, he changed his mind and did not carry out the destruction he had threatened. Father, I pray, Holy Spirit, in the brief time that we have here, Lord, would you communicate your heart, your mind, your will to your people? We are the people of your pasture. We belong to you. Let us hear your voice and know your thoughts for our lives through the preaching of your word, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and grab your seat as we speak on the topic. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. I want to speak to you on the subject of part three, God of the second chance. Well, really, it should be a different title. It should be God of another chance. Because how many have had a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance? Who's experienced a fifth chance, a sixth? Endless. Our recap is that part one, we covered the man, Jonah the man, who refused to go to Nineveh. And we talked a lot about that. We talked why he wouldn't go, the why factor. And you need to go back, listen to that. Last week, we talked about the miracle where he was spat out of the belly of the beast. We talked about the difference of grace and truth. We talked and said that the test of Christianity was not our love for Jesus, but our love for Judas. And we talked about the depth and level of mercy for that. This week, we're looking at part three, the message and the mission of this man, revisiting him a second time. God revisits him with his assignment a second time. You know my thoughts on it. I would have probably thought, let's go and find somebody who will do the job. But no, God was still committed to Jonah doing what he was born and what he was called to do. Don't you love God's grace and mercy that he will go as far as he possibly can with you so that you fulfill your purpose and your mission in life? And so the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. The devil wants you to think because you lied, you stole, you were drunk, you got high, that he wants you to think that because you've done these things that he removes his assignment from you. No one's encouraged to do that, but God already knew you were going to do it and still was committed to your assignment. He already knew that Jonah was going to travel and want a desire to go 4,000 kilometers left when he should have gone right. He already knew what Jonah was going to do to turn his back on God. But Jonah turns his back on God. God never turns his back on his assignment for Jonah. And so we are looking at the God who gives people a second chance. I remember Kate, I think she ducked out or something and said, would you look after Bonnie when she was a baby, our oldest? And just change her nappy if it needs changing. Bonnie had done a number on her nappy and filled it with substantial content. And it was noticeable because the aroma, the atmosphere changed. And I undid her nappy and cleaned her up, and it was all fairly acidic and red and raw. And I thought, you know, she needs something to be soothed there. I don't know if I told you all this before, but I thought maybe something creamy can go on there and it'll fix it up, and I'll put Vicks on there. And I couldn't understand why the child wouldn't stop crying. But I am thankful for a second chance. Because when Kate came back, she had words with me. It's okay. Sometimes when you mess up and you don't get it right the first time, you can be thankful you can have another go at it. A couple were married and celebrated their 35th wedding anniversary. During their party, a genie turns up and says, look, for 35 years of loyalty for one another, I'm going to give you a wish each that I cannot reverse, so think seriously about it. And he turns to the wife, and the genie says, look, you know, if you had another chance at life, what would you like to do? And what do you want? And she said, well, I've always wanted to go for an around-the-world cruise. Genie waves the hand, and she's off. Got the ticket for around-the-world cruise. Genie looks at the husband, says, if you had another chance and you want something right now, what would it be? He said, oh, man, I'd do anything to be married to a woman 30 years younger than I. He waves his hands and turned him 90. Sometimes you only get one chance. Make it count. As much as this message is really good to encourage you that we serve a God of the second chance, let's be real about life, because sometimes you only get one chance. The thief on the cross only had one chance and made it count. And Jesus said, this day you will be with me in paradise. Don't necessarily look for the second or third one, but do everything you can to make the first one count. Who can say amen? Jonah went 4,000 kilometers left. Man, he should have gone right, but we can thank God. And I want to encourage us this month about the depth of God's mercy, because it outstrips any measure that we carry. Rahab, the prostitute, was given a second chance. Moses, Samson, and King David were all given a second go. Hezekiah's life was extended an extra 15 years because he was given another chance. The Saul of Tarsus, the great man who wrote most of the New Testament, was given another go. The woman caught in adultery was given another chance. The prodigal son, which we heard a little bit from Todd this morning, was given another chance. If you feel discarded here and you're watching online and you feel like life has abandoned you and it's put you on the ash heap of life and you feel dejected and maybe you are overwhelmed by your own failures and you lie and you sit here despondent and discouraged about what you've done and how you could have done it better, I'm here to tell you that God is the God of the second, the third, and another chance, and you give Him half a chance with your life and look to Him and lean on Him and repent, turn from your ways if you've gone a way you shouldn't have, and watch what He'll do with you. I do like the mercy of God. I love, oftentimes I've prayed, I said, God, do you think you can help me understand more of your grace? I could do with understanding that more. Lord, help me. Sometimes it's too easy, Father, to judge a book by its cover. Sometimes it's too easy to sentence someone before you even have known their entire background. Lord, would you help me and give me grace with people, because I'm leading people, I'm leading the church, I need patience, I need tolerance, and would you give my wife a lot of grace for me too? Peter has messed it up. I don't have it on the screen, but in John 21, he has messed it up good. And in verse 11, Jesus turns up to Peter, who's walked away, gone fishing. And don't you love it, in John chapter 21 here, that Jesus, when he turns up, is making breakfast for him on the beach, for a guy that denied him three times, for the guy that let him down, for a guy that disappointed him, for a guy that rejected him, for a guy that walked away from him, for a guy that knew the Messiah and all the power and the glory of God that was going through him, who put his faith in him, just walked away from all of it, all of it. And Jesus, full of love and grace and mercy, turns up on the beach not to discuss his mistakes, but to focus on his mission. Not to center on his failure, but to look to his future, and makes him breakfast on the beach. Who loves that setting here? He makes him breakfast on the beach. Sometimes we beat ourselves black and blue over the past, and all that God is focused on is your future and all that you're called to rise to. And will do everything it can in the Father's heart to get you to hear and not remind you of all that's there. We get too much caught up with there instead of here and overwhelmed by it all. And this morning we're speaking to people because God wants to give you a second chance. Now, a second chance may not overturn the consequences of a first chance. However, a second chance can provide a new beginning, a new wisdom, and a new start. So this morning, a marvelous opportunity to right your wrongs. It's a second chance at making that marriage work, because God is committed to making it work. Make it work. Make the marriage work, because God is committed to it. You can do it. It's a second chance at a new business, a second chance at your health, a second chance. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. How many teams have been behind in a football game in the first half and then come out with a different attitude in the second half, and a team that's been behind by 30 points, 40 points, 50 points has determined to make the second half better than the first half and not repeat what was done there, but to change things around in mindset, in attitude, in faith and focus. Some of us need to understand that it's only half time for you. It's not over. Jonah made a mess of his first half, but in his second half, experienced great revival. I want to cover in this theme here that God is not only the God of a second chance, He is the God of a second touch. Jonah was not the only man who was touched by God a second time. If you look at it in your Bible, in Matthew 8, 23 to 25, not on the screen, but in your Bible, Jesus does this. He laid his hands on this man and asked him, "Can you see now?" So he prays for this man. He says, "Can you see anything?" And the man looked around, who was blind at the time, and said, "I see people, but I can't see very clearly. They look like trees walking around." Then Jesus places his hand on the man a second time, and his eyes were open, and his sight was completely restored, and he could see everything clearly. The blind man went from hazy to whole. In the first touch, it was blurred, but in the second touch, he was completely blessed. In the first touch, it was close enough, but in the second touch, it was good enough. Sometimes you just got to keep believing and having faith and don't walk away from something after the first attempt. If you're believing for your healing, if you're believing for your breakthrough, if you're believing for provision, if you're believing for a miracle, if you're believing for heaven to move on your behalf, if you're believing for mountains to be moved, don't just believe it after the first attempt. Come the second time, come the third time, come the fourth time, believe the fifth time. Hold on to the word of God the sixth time. Hold on to the promises of God the seventh time, because His promises are yes and amen. They're powerful and true, and God is able to do abundantly above and beyond all that you can ask or think or imagine. Keep believing. Keep practicing. Keep moving that limb that you're believing God to heal. Keep exercising your faith. Don't just do it for the first attempt. Amen. Keep at it. Faith comes from hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and 7 and 8 and 9 and hearing and 10 and 11 and hearing and 13 and 14 and hearing and hearing. Baptize yourself in the Word of God. I can see people like trees, but the second touch brought clarity. Someone, I feel prophetically here, in your second touch and your second encounter, great clarity is coming. I was really blessed by Kate, who'd come back from Geelong visiting the kids. She said, "You know, our son has come up with an idea for a second business." I said, "What on earth is he thinking about now?" And his second business has got a dimension to it where it raises passive income for him. His first business is working real hard and doing real well. But who would have thought this second idea is bringing... You don't know what the second touch will do. Hey? The first touch is paying your bills. The second touch will pay your debt off. The first touch... The first touch, I saw them like trees. The second touch, I see great clarity. I feel like I'm speaking to people here that are looking for clarity. Press in. Don't walk away from the first attempt. And don't walk away from your first prayer. How many here know what I'm... Who am I talking to here? How many know what I'm talking about here? Who are the people here? Come on, who are our friends here who have had to keep pressing and pressing and... Give me a wave. Come on. Pressing and pressing and pressing and pressing. Some stuff just doesn't come easy. Thank God for the stuff that does. The blind man could have said after the first touch where I see people like trees, he could have said, oh, well, at least I can see a little. I might not see clearly, but I suppose something's better than nothing. The first touch was incomplete. The second touch was complete. Don't settle for mediocrity. Often we settle for mediocrity and commonplace when God has an uncommon blessing. We can be content with where we are, but we shouldn't be satisfied with mediocrity. I'll never break this addiction. I suppose I'll just have to live with it. I'll never get married, but at least I've got some friends. I'll never get out of debt, but at least I can pay my bills. We're like the blind man saying, it's blurry, but at least I can see something. Come on. Come on, a bit of grunt, faith, belief. Come on. I'm going to do a series in August on Bible prophecy and the end times. Hear me now. I have been taken by a passage of Scripture for many, many years when Jesus says, when the Son of Man comes back, did you hear what I said? When the Son of Man comes back, watch what his statement is or question. Will he find faith on the earth? What's he saying? Come on, what's he saying? Do you want to know what he's saying? Who wants to know what he's saying? Yeah, wait till August. I'm telling you everything now. Well, work it out yourself. Amen. I was with Pastor Jeff Hodgkinson having lunch, and he told his church at one stage, you're on your own now. Well, work it out yourself. I thought that's a good piece of advice sometimes. Find it yourself. But I will tell you in August. The second touch is where God can open the door that no one could have opened. No one could have. Because you kept at it. You did not walk away from the first attempt. You kept at it. Bang! The door opens. Many, many people are called. But the second touch you're chosen. The second attempt. Many are called, but few are chosen. What's that say? Many, many, many are called at the first attempt. That's what that tells me. But few are chosen. Few put their hand up and say, I'm in. Maybe you don't have to wait for the second time around. Just buy in immediately. Who can say amen? Buy in immediately to what he has for you. The first touch was hazy. The second touch was whole. The first touch was incomplete. The second one complete. Someone here needs their passion renewed. Someone's faith in Christ and your faith in the church needs to be restored. There are good reasons why you may need that restored, but you need it restored. Someone's dream needs to be revived. Someone's health has got to come good. Someone needs to be blessed financially here. Someone's just got to get down, out, right and happy for a change. Stop walking around sucking on lemons. You know what I mean? Stop blaming everybody else for stuff. Stop saying life's unfair and unjust because it is sometimes. Stop this, stop that. You know what? Get yourself to a place where you can find a little bit more joy and happiness in a shift of your own mindset and come into everything that Jesus Christ has for you. Come on. Get a hold of that first message that I said when Jonah said to the guys, pick me up and throw me over the overboard. Remember I said that? I said, what's he asking someone else to do what he can do? Don't wait. Don't wait for someone to turn up for you with regards to life's opportunities. What if that person never turns up? Secondly, lastly, can I have Dave, you here with the keyboard? God of the second chance, God of the second touch. Be honest. Maybe it's been a long while since you've had a fresh touch of the Spirit. Maybe your spirit might be dry. Maybe you're going through the motions. As Christians, we're good at doing that. We've all done it. Maybe you're treading water instead of gaining ground. Maybe it's been such a long time since the Holy Spirit has come and touched your life afresh. I pray that'll happen for you. I pray that when that happens, there are doors that unlock themselves that have been slammed shut for so long because they've been dependent upon you having another encounter in God. God is also the God of the second wind. Jonah's first wind blew him to Tarsus, but his second wind drove him back to his destiny. And I want to finish with this great scripture here where Elijah felt despondent and depleted and exhausted. Jonah was depleted and exhausted in the belly of the whale. You don't have to be in the belly of a whale to feel completely defeated, a failure, exhausted, and weary. And Elijah was such a man. And in 1 Kings 19:7, it says that he was discouraged here. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. And all at once, an angel touched him. Thank God for the touch of God. And said, get up and eat. He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. Where's that stuff come from? Read the scripture. That's amazing how that appears. He ate and drank and then lay down again. Verse 7. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. Maybe I'm speaking to somebody here that it's just been too much for you. It's just been too much. I feel in my spirit, I'm speaking to people here today and online where life has just been too much for you. We can have the rest of the band come too. Who am I speaking to today and online? Will you resonate with that? That life has been too much for you. There are people here who feel overwhelmed by what's happening right now. There are various reasons to why you're listening to this right now and you feel overcome by whatever it is that's heavy for you. And I just love it how God has an angel and touches him a second time and says, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. Who am I speaking to today where it's too much for you? At that very moment, at that very time, in that very place, God looks down from heaven upon a despondent and discouraged man who saw the power of God move, if you know the story. Elisha had seen so much of the miraculous power of God in his life. Can you believe this guy here? He has seen the might and majesty and force and power of God at work, and he's exhausted. Who's the person sitting here today? You've seen God's goodness. You know God's heart, but you are still overwhelmed by saying it's all too much for me. And yet God has prepared a place where he can eat and drink and refresh himself. And the second time round, he says, now get up on your feet and get going. And strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb. Don't you like the supernatural empowerment of God for a person to go 40 days and 40 nights to get to where he needs to be? The second wind, he's depleted, he's discouraged, but a new fresh wind gets in under the sails of his life and begins to propel him to where he needs to go. And he can do that for you. He can do that for the discouraged soul here. He can do that for the wearied soul, the exhausted, the fatigued, the unmotivated, the depressed, the failed soul, the soul that is overcome with grief and loss, the soul that is weighed down. He can do it for you because he's the God of the second chance. How many can give him praise for that? Who can give God a praise break here? Jesus, we thank you that that's who you are. The God of the second chance. He's remarkable. And I'll finish with this. I signed up to play for a soccer club in Adelaide. It was a private club. I trained, I put my effort in. I did everything I needed to do. The drills, the discipline, the practices, everything. And then the time came to pick the team, to select the team. And don't you love it? Who's been in a lineup where everybody gets picked but you don't get picked? Come on, talk to me. Anyone? Come on. Am I among friends here? What? You guys need special prayer here, man. There's a good number of you. You think you're going to get picked. You do all the work and you think you're going to get picked. You think you're going to be chosen. And you do all the hard work only to find out that you miss out on selection. And that was me. I got so discouraged, I hung the boots up, took the Guernsey off, said, stuff it. I'm not picking boots up, not putting no Guernsey on anymore, blow it. I gave it a good go. I gave it one go. It's a good go. Wasn't picked. Maybe that's not my calling. Maybe I wasn't called. Maybe I should do something different. Maybe I should just walk away from it all. I wasn't picked, I wasn't chosen. Be amazing for you to know how many people in over 30 years of ministry with Kate and I who don't feel like they've been picked and walk out. Incredible. Let's not go there, but. And so I wasn't picked. A friend of mine comes up to me. I'm doing VCE year 12. And he said to me, he's a great soccer player. He said, our high school's putting a team together, a soccer team, for inter-school competition. Zoran, why don't you come out to training? I thought, oh, man. How many of you know you have flashbacks? Hey? How many of you know your second attempt, all that's screaming at you, is your first attempt? Who knows what I'm talking about, hey, man? And your first attempt is screaming at you. Don't go to training. You've tried that. Don't go there. You've already had a go at that. Don't. Just don't even bother. Don't put all the energy and the effort in it. You've prayed once. Stop praying. You believed and you've kept believing. Give it a rest. Listen, you know, you had a good go, but don't worry about it. Forget about it. No, we would love you to come. Come practice. I go and time for selection comes and I get selected this time. Now, back those days, I had a bit of speed. And I had considerably more motion and movement back then. And I got put on the right wing because of the speed. Got me number 7 in the back. The inter-school competition's about to begin. And the coach says to us, before we get into the serious side of the business, a private club has asked her to do a friendly with them. And when they named the private club, how many know where this story's going? Come on, are you there or what? No, you're not there. Wait, the best is yet to come. We played the club that didn't select me. I'm on the right wing, and at the end of the game, this man here had driven two goals into their nets. And I scored two goals, and the coach that didn't select me the first time came up to me. I remember one goal, man. I'm on the far right wing here, man. Just after halfway, I thought I'm going to have a go. I popped my foot in under that ball. It sailed such a distance up to the top left corner. I'm still feeling it now talking to you. All the guys came around, high-fived me. At the end of the game, the guy who was in the private club, the coach, he came up to me, looked me fair square in the eye. He said, Zoran, he said, we have made a terrible mistake. Would you come back to the club? It gave me such incredible pleasure to look at him and say no. That team that I was in, we beat them, every school that we played against, and we won the premiership that year, and I got the opportunity to experience the joy of that. Somebody here has got to understand that you do not quit on your first attempt, despite how much failure is yelling at you, despite how discouraged you are, despite how depleted you are, despite how despondent and disappointed you are in your own efforts. Someone's got to find the second wind, the second touch, the second chance, and not allow the things of the past, the failures and disappointments of yesterday, to rob what God has for you today and tomorrow. Don't allow it. Come on, let's stand for a minute. Don't allow it. Come on, we're going to worship God. I don't know what you're going to sing, man, but I'm sure it'll be something about Jesus. Yeah. Come on. I feel like I've been speaking to people today. You're watching online, I feel like I've been reaching out to you. Don't you just walk away from your first attempt. Don't do it. Okay, yeah. We get it. It was not a pleasant experience. Stuff happened that you didn't even expect to happen. But don't you walk away from your faith. Don't you walk away from your heart after God. Don't you abandon what He has placed within your heart and in your spirit, because He's not going to abandon it. Come on. We need a second wind and an encounter with Jesus Christ to rekindle our heart. We need His Holy Spirit to revive something within us. Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Fresh wind. Fresh touch.